You have any question?
Mà hỏi gì không?
Nhiều quá gì?
No problem.
Where are you from?
Chile.
Chile?
Yes.
Oh, Chile. They eat a lot of chili picante? Yeah? A lot? A lot in Chile? Huh? Aki? No? What? Don't eat chili in Chile?
Yes.
You do? Yeah, it's Spanish. Hot, huh? Woo! Rico! Rico! Like Mexican?
Yes.
You eat like Mexican people? Food? Chili? Picante? Chili. Yeah. And then chili, they eat extra chili, no?
Muy
picante. Más picante. Yeah. Oh, no, not for me, no. They speak Spanish there too, huh? Hola, español and chili? You see? Okay, good, good. Then we can communicate in English. Because I don't know Spanish. I can read it. Yeah.
I just met a lady from Chicago. She just looked at my picture and she saw white light already. And you have to sit there 3 hours and see nothing. Gosh. Same with you. Yeah, you know, from Chicago, there was the lady. Just talk to me, I don't know her name. Is she here? Oh, yeah, she's behind her. Look at that, look at that. I'm telling you, right? Okay. Yeah. Right, you say you just saw, you both saw my picture only?
Yes.
And then you saw white light already. And then she read the book and could put the book down. That's what she just told me. Yeah. And shame on you. Sit there and listen to all this initiation instruction and know how to cross leg and all that and don't see nothing. You tell me you don't see nothing? She's black and she see white light and you all you see black. That's funny stuff. I'm sorry if I say you're black, honey. I'm yellow, by the way. Just very near. You know, when God made us in the oven, test, yeah? Test of our endurance, the black people come out with flying black color. And everybody else are pale because they came out first. Now, the black people endure the most, they stay right behind until the last minute. Yeah, until God says, all right, y'all come out, and then they come out. That's why they're all black. They're all cooked, you know, well done. We are just a medium rare or, you know, half baked. So they're so pale, you know, like the Sophie and you know, like me, you know. You just take things for granted, you know. Your situation sometimes are too good, okay? Too good. And you just kick back and relax. And wait for God to come, whenever He comes. And other people, sometimes their situation, okay, never mind. Food. I know my standing don't make much difference. Even with my high heels and everything, I still don't look much different than I said. Sorry, I have to do this. Because some of us, you know, some of us, including myself, we have the situation so good. Huh? Oh, I'm sorry if you don't understand English, okay? Okay? 对不起，还没有翻译嘛？ 那没关系，我讲英文可以哈。 那个我们有个经验， thôi đáng ngồi đó nha. Ngày mai mình mới có cái hệ thống phiên dịch đó. Ngày mai mới bắt đầu mà. Ngày mốt mới bắt đầu chứ hả? Ngày mai bắt đầu, ok? Quý vị ngồi tạm đó coi dọn cho đỡ liền. Thanh thanh về bù tò hả? Quý đã lộ sổ lại khám bù tò. Còn không muốn là thôi tôi đi ha. Ai giận thì thôi tôi đi nha. Yeah, I just have to apologize to those people. And any other language I don't speak of, you know, please just sit there. And if you don't want, you can leave. It's a free America. Okay. So, go back to our situation. Many of us, our background, our situation is too good. You know, like we're rich. Maybe not very rich like Rockefeller or whatever fella, but we have enough means to survive, you know, and we can go see Madame Qinghai anytime we want. So it's kind of, we take it for granted, you know. And so when we meditate, we don't concentrate very well. And that's why we don't have such a deep, sincere, and burning longing in our heart. And that's why we have very less experience compared to people in a less fortunate, so-called less fortunate circumstance, materially or physically. Like the people, for example, in some of the restricted countries like China or Vietnam or other communist countries, all their experience are exceptional. You know, huh? You know very well, huh? When you saw them, now they tell you, huh? Or sometimes they write it on a magazine anonymously, because we don't want, normally we don't want people to know who's having a higher level, who's not. Because like this is also no good for the high level person. Such is the nature of the human beings that whatever is not in our level, is higher, then we pull them down. Thing like that, we try, or we feel jealous and envious, and we send bad vibration to those people, and they affect their spiritual practice too. That's why I told you, don't tell people your experience. Understand? Even to the fellow practitioners, sometimes you can never tell whether they are up to that yet or not. Huh? You see, example, Jesus came, Buddha came, Mohammed came, and you know, all these gurus, all these masters came. And what did we do, the human race? Kill them, torture them, make trouble for them. Just because they're too high for us. We can't comprehend this kind of greatness. So we just have to tear them apart to see what's inside. This is our human nature. And after we tear them apart, we kill them or we torture them and then punish them, and then we love them again. And then if they come back with all glory, we begin to... Yeah? The same in political situation. Yeah? Anytime a president is voted, you know, and half of the population will tear him apart. If not, he would have done a great deal more for the country than he could have done, or he did, or she did, whatever, okay? The master, or maybe any great political leader also. Most of great leaders, they have spiritual aspiration in their heart, and that's why they're great. And if not, they're just a politician, a bad one at the most. If they don't have spiritual sustain in their soul, they cannot be even good politician, understand? Can't be good at anything. So spiritual attainment is the foremost important thing in this life we have to achieve before we want to achieve anything else, be it financial status, fame, name, or politics. We want to lead people, we have to lead ourselves first out of darkness. And let it be a reminder to us that even in our favorable situation, we always have to try to remind ourselves that God comes first. God, that is our true self. I'm not here to preach you that I have a new every day to God and worship Him, because if there is such a God, He doesn't need us.
to worship him anyhow. But let's remember that he is us. God are us. God is us. And so we have to remember our great self in order to survive first and then to get out of darkness in this world. Because in favorable situation and in happiness physically, we tend to forget what is the most important thing. We forget. And then we plunge back to suffer again, and then we scream again, and then we pray to God and all that. And it's sometimes too late. We already suffer. Huh? So it is better that we remind ourselves every day, try to endeavor. Huh? Before you sit to meditation, try to pray to God in any way that is dear and is touching your heart. Pray to God, pray to the inner master, pray to your inner self, pray to Buddha, whomever you feel is the dearest to your heart. Please help me to remember who I am. Please help me to be enlightened more and more every day. And that's it. Once enough. If you sincerely pray, once time, once is enough. Because you yourself hear it. If you're not sincere, you can shout the whole day long. Huh? You yourself know it don't work. Because you don't put the whole self in that prayer. And that's why it doesn't work. But sometimes it works, the prayer, you know, because when you're so desperate already and so down and you know you're really down, you pray. At that time you see the light. Even if you ordinarily don't see it, or difficult for you to see otherwise, at that time you will see. Is that not so? Have you experienced? Yeah? How come so small? Yes. Only two or three? Yeah, two? Oh, okay. Yeah. I'm just saying out of my own experience, if you don't have it, then you don't have to say yes. But you can try. You can try again. Huh? If we fail, we have to stand up and do it again. Every day we have to renew our strength in God and in our practice and in what is beautiful and truth and glory. We cannot just sink in this material world and material comfort and material kind of life forever. We cannot, because we are not that. We are not that at all, including this body. Now we still remember it, so we still stay here. But in samadhi, we don't remember the body even. The body don't exist. And we know we are not the body at all. At that time, we know our true selves. And all of us have to endeavor to reach that state of selfless. And then you will know what God is, truly God is. At the moment, we only know God as abstract being, like bless us, help us do this, do that, and answer our prayers. And we already know God to some extent. But it's not enough. It's not enough that every day we pray for material comfort and to solve some problem to us and all that. It's not enough. We have to reach the state of being one with God. Then we know. We know we are God, and we are children of God, and we are God also. That is the state that Jesus, Buddha, and other masters have attained. And we must endeavor to attain that too. There's nothing more worthwhile in this world, is it? Huh? I told you many times, suppose you become the king of the whole world, and then what? Would you eat more than 6 times a day and get fat? And then you have problem, you have to go to liposuction, whatever. Or diet, you know, or exercising, and I'm sweating a lot, and it might not even help. No? And suppose you become a president of a country, and then what? What else do we have? We still go out empty-handed. It's okay to work and earn money and strive to be successful, yeah? Because that's the sport. We do it. Just like if we go into a football field or basketball field, we have to play as the best. As the best as we know how. But that doesn't mean that's the only thing that we should do in this world. That's just by the way. Huh? Just by the way. Mm. If we do not remember this, then if we sit so long, we don't have experience. The people who have experience also have to remind themselves, don't be too proud, don't be too relaxed, because there will be more, a lot more to go. Huh? Always there are higher levels. There's no end, there's no roof to our attainment, like, okay, and I hit the roof and finished. It's not. There's always more happiness, more bliss waiting for us at every step of the way, at every level of consciousness. So we always have to continue. And that's what is worth living for. Otherwise, if we live another 100 years, and then what? Huh? Eat and sleep, watch TV, that's it. It's not much to do. Huh? Sometimes it's very boring here. So actually, when you say thank you to me, I think I deserve it. Because I have teach you some way to pass your time. Huh? In this boring world. Suppose you don't have meditation, wow, how boring can it be? Huh? Sometimes, huh? Remember before? You go to karaoke, you go to discotheque, you go to movies, and then what not? What next, you know? Every day sometimes you don't want to get up because you don't know what to do next. Even if you have a lot of money and you can go to party every week or every 2-3 times a week, you still feel bored, huh? You eat a lot of food, you know, caviar and vodka and whiskey and all that, and then you have hangover, and then hang around, and then hang your head down. There's nothing much, is there, huh? Yeah, that's all you can get in this world. And you wear a lot of jewelry like me, and then what? Oh no, today is not, this is a cheap one, about $10. This is not my design, this is my design, okay? Actually, if you don't want to buy any of my design, you know, I mean, that's okay. I understand, because I don't want to wear them either. Now and again, okay, you know, if it's a special occasion, because it's very tiring, huh? I understand. I like to wear those, you know, $5 and things from Kmart or Target, thing like that. You know, that's simple, easy. And you wear those simple clothes, huh? Run around, very comfortable. Mm. Yeah, as soon as I go back to my room or my house, I take this off immediately. Yeah, as soon as I get out of your sight, I'm just all off. Because the official clothes always make you feel too official, huh? Not relaxed. That's why I always advise you, when you go to group meditation, you don't need to put makeup on. You just wear very simple, elastic kind of clothes, so comfortable so you can sit. And you feel relaxed and you can forget about the body. All these official clothes is only for official function. Otherwise, it reminds you too much of the physical body and it doesn't make you feel good. It's not a sin. It's not a sin to wear beautiful clothes. It's not. It's just too uncomfortable, too self-conscious, yeah? Make you aware of your beauty and your body, and it's all this illusion anyhow. Doesn't matter how beautiful we are, it's not real, right? It's not real. Because if it is real, we can maintain it all the time, from childhood until old age. It's not real. That's why we change every day. Things decay, huh? And it's not a sin to take care of the physical body and the need, or put on jewelry and all that. But too much conscious of the physical level make us heavy, huh? Pulled down to the physical level, and it's difficult to rise up in meditation. That's all, okay? Yeah? Huh? Okay. So whenever you need to put makeup on, then you do that, huh? And if you don't need, just wipe it off, be yourself and meditate, huh? Except when you have a very choosy husband and he wants you to put makeup on, then do that. Okay? To keep him. If you can't live without him, then you have to keep him. And if you can't live without him, then say goodbye. Just that in this world we have to look decent, you know, in a very appropriate circumstance so people don't think we are weird. Huh? Because anything weird repulse people, you know, make them feel that we are alien and we are strange people and untrustworthy. This is human nature. Anything look different from them, they destroy. They want to disturb, they want to make trouble. We already look very much the same, and a lot of people still want to disturb us for no reason. Sometimes we don't do anything at all. They still smell it. They smell that we have something different. Something that they do not yet want to have because of their choice of life. I told you many times that people come here with different choice of life, right? Sometimes they choose to transmigrate in this lifetime hundreds or thousands of times before they come back to the kingdom of God. That's their choice, okay. But they like to keep us here with them because they don't want us to go home first. Yeah, they say, why? It's still fun. Because of their choice, because of the nature of their choice, they feel the world is still fun. Yeah? And the world is only fun when a lot of people play around with them. If suppose their friend gone, their wife gone, their kids gone, they will feel lonely. Even if they want to play, they want to drag everybody around and stay with them to play together. And that's the reason why a lot of other souls try to obstruct the elevating soul, try to obstruct the spiritual practitioners. It's like that. Just like kids also, you know. They're small and they want to play a lot. And they like to drag sister and brother, even though they grow up, you know, more a teenager, they play a different game. Or parents don't want to play children game anymore. But the kids, the children, always like the sister and brother or the elder friend to play with them. You know, like to retain them, retain them in the playground with them, even the parents. You see what I mean? Not that the kids are bad, they're just at that level. They love playing. And that thing is fun, to play with plastic doll and plastic toys and, you know, play seesaw and all kind of these kids' games. Oh, they feel fun, they can play all day long. And we, the adults, pass already, and we're tired of it. But sometimes we have to stay around and play with kids. And sometimes you have kids, you play like kids too, right? Just for their sake. And you wear, you know, Mickey Mouse clothes and all that kind of thing too. And you wear, you know, reindeer kind of horn and all that, just to play with kids, huh? And sometimes around the kids, you feel like a kid too. Yeah, and you forget yourself as an adult. But we don't forget that often. We don't forget all day long. We don't forget 24 hours. And that is the difference between a spiritual practitioner and a non-spiritual practitioner. They are still kids. Let them play their game. And we sometimes play with them. Like we put on makeup, we put on jewelry, and we do this, do that, just like they do. But we are aware that we are different, that we're bored with the mundane physical game, huh? So now you understand, huh? But don't be a kid forever, just like a parents, huh? A parents can play with kids sometimes, huh? But you have to remember yourself as a grown-up, no? Well, you can't help but remember, because you have your work to do, right? Your money to earn, and the whole family to take care. Even if you don't want to remember that yourself an adult, you have to remember. Similarly, when we grow up spiritually, we cannot play ignorant person anymore, even though sometimes we do. Yeah? For time being, for an hour, for half an hour, half a day, maybe one day, 2 days, 1 month, but not forever, because we already awakened. We already grown up spiritually. We are ready to take on the responsibility as saints, as Buddhas. We cannot pretend to be spiritually children anymore. And that's the difference. And that's why we do the way we do. That's why we have to meditate. That's why we have to keep the precept. That's why we eat the vegetarian. We have no other choice anymore. Even if we want to try, go back to McDonald's or whatever, we just eat the French fries. Right? You bring the whole restaurant here. Oh my God. Make people envy. Okay, anyhow, go back to where? I'm thankful to you, yes, to some of you, not all of you, and some of you who try to do this and do that and arrange this, arrange that, you know. I do know that it's a very difficult thing to do, organizing a retreat, because there are 1,001 things to take care, you know. In such a holiday season, and to book a hotel in the middle of a capital city for many thousands of people, it's not easy, huh? And it's not that we have a lot of personnel in Washington, D.C. Anyhow, but I'm grateful, so sometimes for your arrangement or your request. Without you, I would not do much. Yeah, the most would be take care of your letters, you know, approving some of the manuscript, and, you know, proofread something, and sing along, watch movies, huh? Watch a video, thing like that, and hang around. So, because I don't think I have much to do anymore. You tend to feel peaceful inside, don't you? After some times of practice, and you don't want to do anything. That is the truth, huh? Before enlightenment, you still want to run here and there and, oh, do this, do that, save the world, you know. And after a while, you feel everybody's okay. Whatever they choose to live their life is fine, it's fine. But then luckily, some big bodhisattva, you know, with great vow from the past lives, come here to save the world for me. And then they would think of doing this, doing that, doing others, you know. So all the work are done by you. Most of the work are done by you. The initial works have done by me, you know, like I was invited to go here, go there and lecture, and then I did go. And then so I saw the seeds of awareness among the people, and then from then on you continue to do your job, huh? And then now I don't feel like there's much to do. So it's good sometimes like this that somebody requests, you know, even outside people. This party, this retreat would not take place if there has not been for family. The great musician family, remember last time in Long Beach? Last year, same time? Yes, the one who played all kind of Vietnamese ancient instruments. Yeah, and they made it themselves, and they modified it into different type, remember? Yeah, that great family. They want to do something before they retire. That's what they told me. I hope they won't retire afterward, but, you know, they just think they want to do something the last time. And they requested that they would make kind of my teaching into music. Some of my poetry and my teaching composed into music and make it into a kind of Zen music. Yes. Just like Kitaro, yeah? Chitaro? Yeah, this kind of new age, something like that, old age, whatever. And then, because they were very sincere, you know, and some of our fellow practitioners support them, support their ideas. And I would feel a great, kind of great discomfort if I refuse such great people. And if they want to do something good for the world, you know, to add into the melodies of this world some more Zen kind of breathing, some more poetic and noble kind of music, how can I refuse? So that's how this event takes place, yeah? Because we are, since they are having a great night of musical, I'll say, a performance on the 27th. And so the practitioner also asked that may it be also a retreat before that. Yeah? By the way, you know what I mean? To pray for world peace and pray for our peace and whatever. And then we celebrate afterward, just by the way. So this retreat come into realization because of one of the non-initiate people. No, a family. You see what I mean? So anything can trigger our practice. So if we, the practitioner, don't have such enthusiasm don't have such a patience and sincerity for spiritual practice, we would really feel ashamed of ourselves. Because even the non-initiate people, they are so sincere and so, I would say, earnestly wanting to do something for the world. And so we should be the more so. Capisce? Okay, I don't know what else to say. All right, so you know already, huh? You know why we're here, huh? Yeah, okay. Anyhow, this is the capital of America, Great America, so behave yourself like a capital. You feel good here?
Yes.
Yeah. It's a city of culture. It's a city of high class, of international peacemaking and war decision. Choose peace. Anyhow, this is a working city, huh? You feel restless a little here or not? Huh? You don't? Well, I do. Couldn't sleep last night. I don't know what they did to my room. Too many people arranging my room and I couldn't sleep, you know? I feel like... That's why most of the time when I come to any place, I just sneak in. I don't let any of you know. That's the best. Even in an ordinary hotel, I sleep better. Whenever you arrange, I just keep jumping up and down in the bed, you know. I don't know what to do with myself. too much blessing. Next time, just do it. Don't bless my bed, okay? And don't bless my food, don't bless my kitchen, don't bless anything. Just leave it alone. So then I can sleep a little, have a little rest. I come see you anytime, anyhow. Don't be restless. Okay, all right. Any question? Okay, so I see you. Huh?
How are you, Master?
How am I or how old?
How are you?
Oh, I'm okay. Thank you. I'm okay. No, nothing. Nothing weird, huh? Oh, yeah, please. No, really. No, why? If you don't know, you please ask the person in charge who know. You know, ask the HOFAP or, you know, the guards or whoever, the working staff out there. Huh? Okay, because I don't know either. I tell you truly. The first time I know that this hotel called Hilton is because I came here. Yes. I don't know what street is on and what number even. I don't even know what room. Or anything, you know? I don't know where to go and what to do. So don't rely on me, don't ask me such kind of question. I don't know anything. Okay? Anytime when there is a retreat or the lecture or something like that, I'm driven there and driven back alone. I don't remember where I give lecture and what the address and. So don't ever ask me, okay? I don't remember. I don't know, okay? You ask whoever know, okay? And if that person doesn't know, you go and find someone else. Better ask the working staff, you know, the one who sit there and registers your name and all that. Perhaps they know, okay? They should know. And if they don't know, you tell me and then we both go and ask them. Okay, and make sure the kitchen staff remember to cook food and leave it 24 hours for people who come late to eat. 24 hours, understand? Sometimes if you're hungry, you can go and nip something, but don't nip too much and the next person don't have. And don't eat too much because you can't meditate. 80%, okay? 80% food, 10% water, and leave 10% empty. Okay? Like this, the next meal tastes even better also. Huh? Okay, bye-bye. So long. So long.
I was initiated in July of this year, and for some time throughout the past few years prior to this, I had come to feel feeling empty with my ambitions and my material comforts in the world. And my spirit was thirsty for a deeper sense of meaning in my life, one which I have known and carried with me for quite a few years in my life. I'd been reading yoga philosophy, and through my meditation I prayed to God to send me that fruit for which my soul was so hungry. One day as I was reading at our local spiritual bookstore, I decided to take a break and dine next door at a popular vegetarian restaurant. It was there I came across a small booklet entitled The Key to Instant Enlightenment. I thought, what's this? Now instant enlightenment. Just add water and stir. But as I turned the booklet over, the words, we the disciples of, caught my eye. I was curious by the fact that this seemed to resemble more of a book than a booklet, and it was presented by the disciples of the author, and I was impressed by the amount of work that had obviously gone into it. And I thought, some people must have a great sense and strength in belief to go to all the time and expense to prepare this and offer it free to the public. So I took the book home and I began to read it. The words within it seemed to captivate my spirit, and in the simplicity and honesty in it, they had a great sense of appeal to my inner ideals of truth and meaning. It wasn't that it contained things that I didn't already know, such as vegetarianism, world peace, love of God, world hunger, and the like, but it seemed like I was reading them, the words, for the first time. I could not put the book down, and after reading it, I found myself back at the local bookstore looking for further reading material by this author known as the Summa CHINGHAI. I read all the books I could get my hands on, and within the span of a couple of weeks, I then contacted a meditation center in my area. It was after receiving a warm welcome there from the enthusiastic and loving disciples and after reading these truthful words imparted by the Master, that I then realized what I had been come to looking for. I wanted to become initiated, and I applied at my first visit to the center. After a few months of waiting, my day of initiation had come, and by that time I was doing a lot of reading of the Master's books and was in eager anticipation of being hurled into ecstasy. I had visions of visiting glorious places with jeweled temples and mentally prepared to travel to heaven amid the sweet sounds of trumpets blasting in my soul transformed forever, never to return the same. I had thought of myself as being somewhat spiritually advanced prior to this, and therefore it came to me as a bit of a shock when I found an initiation that these great things that I had been expecting all this time just really didn't happen. But many things went through my mind at this time. Maybe I don't have many merits, I thought, or maybe something went wrong, or maybe I'm just not the idealistic soul that I professed to be and come to know these past years. As I began to think deeper upon this afterwards, and as I continued on with my daily meditation since, I slowly began to grow a bit more comfortable with my expectations. Why should I have any expectations of God at all, I thought, but rather accept the greatness that surrounds me every day? As I looked at myself a bit closer, I began to dissect my own morals and ambitions. It became clearer to me that I was not above or below anybody else, but rather just a man like any other, looking for the same loves and hopes we all look for within. And as I looked deeper, I began to see that all of us were heading in the same direction, just taking different paths. Some higher, some lower, some faster, some slower. And as I looked within my heart, I began to plainly see that this was the gift offered me through my initiation and not the grandeur I had expected. It seems that every time we encounter the truth, its simplicity evades us. As I continue with my meditation these days and try my best to adhere to a simple and honest lifestyle, I stop from time to time and take my comforts and strength from these simple things and thank my inner master and Master ChingHai for her unconditional love and help. Thank you very much.
The next person I would like to introduce is from Montreal, Canada Center.
Je vivais une période difficile avec mon mari car il n'était pas d'accord que j'aille à cette retraite.
I was going through a difficult time with my husband because he was not in agreement, with me coming to this retreat. He did sort of disagree with me coming.
Le dimanche suivant, comme je l'ai médité, la salle de méditation n'était pas prête, je suis sortie.
The following Sunday, I went to meditate, but the meditation room wasn't ready, so I stepped out.
Lorsque je suis revenue, j'attendais la voix de maître au loin, et plus j'avançais vers la salle, je ressentais une grande joie.
When I came back in the room, I could hear Master's voice, and as I was walking into the room, the closer I was getting to that voice, the greater joy I was feeling and experiencing.
J'étais très heureuse d'entendre Maître et ensuite je me suis mise à pleurer car je ne voulais pas que mon mari ait de la peine.
Que mon mari quoi?
Ait de la peine pour, parce que je venais ici.
Oh. And I was feeling greater joy, but at the same time I was a little worried because I was afraid that my husband would, do something that would go against that.
À la fin de la méditation, il y avait un messager pour répondre à nos questions. Il m'a dit même si je n'y allais pas à la retraite d'être heureuse avec mon mari.
A Kuan Yin messenger was there, and at the end of the group meditation, he told me that even if I could not attend the retreat, I'd just, be happy with what I have.
Je me suis décidée à écrire une lettre à mon mari, et je pleurais tellement que je ne pouvais plus écrire.
I was very sad. I was crying a lot, and I was crying so much that I couldn't write down anything.
J'ai prié Maître de m'aider à accepter la situation et j'ai pu terminer ma lettre.
I prayed to Master to allow me to, finish the letter and sort of take myself, back into a more calm space.
Lorsque mon mari est arrivé pour dîner, je lui ai remis la lettre et il m'a dit, ça me dérange pas que tu ailles à la retraite.
And when my husband came back that evening for dinner, I gave him the letter and he read it, and then he turned to me and said, it's okay, you can go to the retreat, I'm all right with it.
J'étais très heureuse de venir ici. Merci encore une fois de prendre soin de moi et de ma famille, Maître.
I was very pleased with that, as you may know, and I thank Master for taking care of everything, including my family. Thank you.
From Chicago, Illinois Center, United States.
Peace, everyone. I was initiated June 1st, 1997. I am also very excited and happy to be here today at this great, great occasion. I first heard about Master ChingHai in August 1996, my husband and I were on vacation in Hot Springs, Arkansas. We were in a shop looking at books and rocks, crystals, and so forth. My husband discovered the book and brought it over to me. And he said, look. I looked at the front and then I opened it, but her picture on the front, there was something special about that picture. When I looked in her eyes, but I began to read it. I couldn't put it down. I put it down and pick it up. And on the way back to Chicago, my husband drove. I read the book periodically to him, just telling him what was going on. And I began to see beautiful colors after this that I'd never experienced before. The bright, bright white light. It was just a wonderful experience. And, telling him, he was excited too. But it was truly a blessing. I felt just really uplifted. And, you know, I've known about the consciousness raising, positive teachings for many years. And I knew that it was really a blessing meeting or finding out about Master CHINGHAI because, you know, she was teaching the same teaching that we were used to, all the wonderful teachings that she brought forth about Jesus and so forth, the truth about him. We were just elated to hear such a wonderful woman come forth, so sincere and serious she sound, but we'd never met her before. And I also had experiences where I've seen like her image in dreams or just closing my eyes to meditate. I've had experiences on my job where problems were solved because of the initiation that I received. My husband also received initiation at the same time, so we're both practitioners. And most of all, yesterday, my first time at a retreat, my first time meeting Master CHINGHAI, I had the opportunity to speak with her one-on-one. And I mean, I was so surprised, I was so shocked, I thought I wasn't going to be able to speak, but I was able to talk to her. And I'm writing a book, and I said, Master, I said, I would like to put your name in my book. She said, oh, you would, huh? She was coming down on the escalator. I was going up on the escalator. That's how it, I believe God planned the meeting in that way. But I turned around and proceeded behind Master and the group. And they were coming into the meditation hall. And I just came in and I stood along the side. And after a while, she turned to me and she waved. And then she looked again and she, oh, I said, she's begging for me to come. And I ran over and some of the security, run. I ran and I mean, it was just amazing. But I just know it was God planning this. And my husband really, he couldn't come, but he encouraged me so much to come. He said, you should go. And I know why now. And I just feel I have so much to share with him and so many other people. We are all truly, truly blessed way beyond our fondest imagination. It's a blessing to follow whatever Master says, eagerly, speedily, whatever, because she is truly, truly God sent. And standing in her presence, you know, it's just a blessing because I just felt the power of God, but a meekness and an humbleness about her, a giving spirit that I know of no one. And I did have a master before who left the body in 1983. So this is my second master. And I thank God because I know we were led to her. Thank you all. Peace.
This concludes the inner experiences for today. We have some good news. We may be blessed with a very important guest. So I ask you all to close your eyes in meditation.
Ah, I'm scared to meditate with you. I can't even sleep here. This is incredible. I thought I'd sleep upstairs, I'd be too cold, you know, lonely. I come here and sleep together with you, but no chance. And then, dit. And then some handicap have to park his car right in front of the road. You know, right in the middle of the walkway. You know, we have this walkway. This is for 1,000 people to walk, not for you to park your car. The you know, the no-wheel car, you know, the handicapped car. It's not a handicapped car. I know you complain when you have some physical problem, but it's just a temporary, you know, like if you have an accident and you broke your leg and you have a cast and just for a while and then you'll be okay again. And don't make everybody else become handicapped. by parking your car on the road, and then I become handicapped too, and then we complain all together. And you just try to catch attention. Yeah? You know, he complained already in L.A. I must go to Washington, D.C. Somebody must take care of me, you know. It's not a must. We take care of you if we want to, because we want to show our care and attention, and you have to say, please, can you help me, or can somebody, you know. Not say, I must go and somebody have to take care of me. Nobody have to take care of you. It's your own karma. Right? Just like some people bring the children in the center and expect that we become bodyguard and babysit all day long. Everybody go there just to meditate, like you do. And if luckily they don't have their lovely karma with them, then you don't throw their karma at them. You know, sometimes you have to watch your manner. This is very rude. Everywhere people try to take care of children and, you know, the temporary handicapped people, but we should not use it, you know, should not abuse it and throw it at everybody's face and everybody else's expense. Whatever we have is our own problem, it's our own karma, we created it. Even if we don't create it, you know, if somebody else wants to help us, there's their own free will and free, you know, and loving voluntarily. We cannot force people to take care of us because we are this, we are that, we are others. There's nobody here owns us anything, and nobody anywhere owns us anything, absolutely, whatsoever. We are in this company, and the employees here are very helpful already. Our company is already the best. So don't try to make it, you know, as if this is the end of the world. And if any one of you want to sit on the chair for any reason, sit on the rear or on the side. Yeah? Don't park yourself right in front of everybody else or right in front of me. I know you have the reason for sitting on the chair. You might have your long leg, you might not be used to it, cross leg, you might have your leg problem, or you might have your pain or something. It's all right. But consider somebody else that don't make everybody painful like you do. It's not necessary, yeah? We are a practitioner. We should be brave, we should be courageous, and we should take care of ourselves and accept whatever condition we are in as much as we can. Unless necessary, we don't trouble other people. Everybody come here for the same purpose. They have the same problem like you do, more or less. They have to go through a lot of problems to come here. They have to pay the money, they have to take holiday sometime, they have to quit the job if they couldn't get it, or if the boss don't feel like give them holiday and things like that. And they have to go through family discussion and be courageous to, you know, go above all obstacles in order to come here. So we all have to respect everybody else's position, you know, and their privilege. Not to come here for you alone, and don't try to catch my attention for yourself alone, because you will have it. When I pay my attention to you, you will see what it's like. Yeah. I don't like people to take advantage of everybody else's and just think of yourself at everybody else's expense. Doesn't matter how much I love you and concern about your condition, I'm concerned about everybody else's well. I don't like people to take, you know, everything for themselves and nothing left for everyone else, you know. When I come down and just one or two of you and make some problem and make me in bad mood, then everybody else have to share that too. You understand? And that is no good. And make sure if you want to come here next time or any time, consider everyone else's position. Your alarm clock we don't need here. You always wake up on time for dinner. Because somebody else will knock you out of your samadhi, or, you know, everybody else will get up and then you know. Normally we have the rule for meditation hall, huh? Don't bring all kind of plastic back and cushion and alarm clock and any titi-tata, like watching the meditation hall. Everyone should know already from the meditation center. But every time you commit the same mistake, and the time here is very short and very valuable. If it's not for you, then for everyone else. So if you don't feel it's valuable, then you stay in your room, meditate, sleep, whatever you want. Nobody is forced to come here. But when you come here, you behave and be responsible. Just thinking, suppose you are in the other person's shoe, what would you feel, what would you think? And don't try to just feel sorry for yourself too much at everybody else's expense, including mine. I'm not always in a good mood, I warn you. You know already very well my temper. Need I advertise on TV? Yeah, when I don't like it, I don't like it. There's no nonsense about me. And if you don't know it by now, God helps you. Okay? Don't always try to stick out so that I can see you. Just sit where you are, I see you, all right. Okay, now it's time. It's fast, huh, today, huh? Just have a little sleep and then 4 o'clock already. What happened is last night I did some research, you know, in here for some of your questions yesterday. Because yesterday I did give you some answer, but after a while I came home I came to my room and I thought there's something else missing. Yeah? And I did some research and I had some answer for you. So I stay up until very late, like maybe, I don't know, maybe 5 o'clock in the morning. Actually, I wanted to come down and meditate with you about 3 o'clock in the morning. But I thought I haven't done my research yet. So do you want any more questions or you want to hear the research? Huh? Okay, just short one, huh? And then you go for lunch, huh? And you're tired now? After a good sleep, are you still tired? I can hear you from very far. You know? After all, I have sympathy with you. You know, every day you're running, either for kids, for their school, or for your work, and you know, for your headache every day for survival. So if you do sleep here, it's all right. It's all right. You make up at home. Meditate at home. Later, don't worry about it. God knows we are in trouble here. Okay. About the first, what was the question first? The lawyer first, right? Actually, you know, in this kind of situation, it is wrong, huh? Because the lawyer is there to protect the company whenever the situation demands. Not always blindly defend for the company, even when the company is wrong. And that's the purpose of having a lawyer anywhere or anytime. Not only for the company, but for private and for any enterprise or any undertaking, huh? Suppose somebody wrong us, right? Accuse us for something that we have not done, or accuse us for something that we rightfully just, huh? Then we have to need a lawyer to defend for us because we do not know much about the law. Huh? And he's more the expert. He can argue for us. Then we need the lawyer. or the attorney, whatever, eh? they should be the one who defend for the weak and help the ignorant or the suppressed persons. So in the case of any company at all also, if the company are wrongly accused and being taken advantage of by the employees or by other company, then the lawyer should be using his best to defend for that company. Then it's okay. That is the best way to use a lawyer or to have a lawyer. It's not just to have it there so that you always win and your company always save money or take money from other people, right? So it is not the lawyer's fault, it's the company's fault. And even if a lawyer for any company or any individual should strive to understand the whole fact and then defend for what is right, and not defend for the client, but defend for justice, then it don't matter. But as in most case, people just make use of the lawyer to win the court case. It doesn't matter whether it is right or wrong, then it is no good. Okay? Yeah. So if you are a lawyer, if you intend to be a lawyer, if you're going to work for any company, for any person, you should bear this in mind. If your client is wrong, tell them they are. And you refuse to defend. Or you can change the policy of the company and say, my profession is to defend for what is right and just. I cannot go over that. And if they fire you, go do something else, selling tofu or something. Huh? I told you yesterday. We don't have to live the life of rich and famous in order to be a human being. The more we strive for outside richness and fame, the more we are slave for all kind of wrongdoing in this world. We should always strive to be righteous and right. And then it doesn't matter what we do. Then we will not fear of anything. You remember the story about Rama in India? When he was nominated to be king, future king, he was ready to be king. And when his father denominated him because of some incident with the queen, the smallest queen, she got jealous and then talked him out of it. So he was denominated and exiled into a very far away country. He was also prepared to go. And people say, are you not sad? You don't stand enough for your right and all that. He said, what for? If I'm given the kingdom, okay, then I will have to fulfill my obligation and do my duty the best as I can. But if the kingdom was taken away from me, ah, good, then I don't have to do it. I have a lot more time to meditate and to think of God, to do something else. When we look like that, it's good. When we look at things that way, we don't feel so confused and struggle inside anymore. We don't care. And that's the right attitude of anybody, especially for the Kuan Yin practitioners. Before I came to D.C., I have already brought a ticket. And one of my companions also. And then when we went to the airport, he forgot, you know, he probably have a different name. He has a different name. And then the other ID card is a different name. And he forgot to take the other new one, yeah? And then the airline didn't let him go. And they make so much trouble, so much fuss, you know. And this is inside America. Normally people don't check the name. I don't know why they did that. And so make so much trouble. And and I was ready to curse the whole company. Because it's the last minute, you know. And they tell us I have to go back, get your ID and come back and all that. And we'll be late and a lot of people waiting for us here, and we couldn't get in touch with them at that time because the organization wasn't that wasn't done properly yet. You know, the telephone and everything is not yet connected. But then I thought, no, don't do that. It may be for something good. And then I just smile. Yeah. It just makes you feel peaceful when you forgive people. And when you think that maybe that is God's arrangement for something else better, or for somebody's benefit. It might not be your benefit, it might be somebody else's benefit. So whatever it is, it's God's arrangement, otherwise it wouldn't happen. That's what I think all the time, you know? And then suddenly another lady jump in from nowhere and say, oh, you can buy another ticket with this ID card. And then, you know, like refund the other ticket, so no problem. And then we go on time. We went on time also. It's not because of the new ticket or anything. It's just the attitude that make you feel so good. Good before the new arrangement come. You already feel good. You already make peace with God and with the whole world within yourself. So this is a very beneficial way for us already, that we can think that way because we meditate, because we're calm in our heart and we don't feel hostile toward any situation or any people. So let alone somebody who has not done us anything wrong, like the client of the other opponent, of the opponent, of the opposition. So as a lawyer or any defender of justice, you should remember this. We rather do ourselves harm than do somebody else harm. In case, only except for self-defense, then you do what you think is right. But normally I just let God does what is right. I don't even bother to defend for myself. What is it to defend for ourselves after all? What do we have to defend for ourselves? To defend for myself so that I live longer in this body? So that I eat more in a few more days or a few more years that I live? Or defense for my fame? What for do I have any fame? And what for does it serve me? Of course, it is good that if our group have a good name, then it's more comfortable for us and we can do a lot of more beneficial things to mankind. But if it doesn't happen that way, then it's all right. Then I have less work to do. And you have less brothers and sisters. I mean, in the same group. Otherwise, they are also our brothers and sisters, even if they're outside our group. It don't matter. We don't lose anything. Okay, there's another question about being bachelor. In the old time, many of the masters, even now, they're married and they have children. But they would advise you, like Saint Paul, or like the Buddha, tell you not to marry. It's not because being married, you cannot become a Buddha, or having some physical exercise with your wife stop you from become one with God. It's not that. It's just that if we are too indulgent in physical awareness, then it's more difficult to rise up as a spiritual level. That's number one. So if you exercise everything in moderate, it's all right. That is number one. Number two, in old time, and even now, but let's talk about old time, why the masters advise people to be bachelor, to be single. In old time, it's more difficult to raise a family than now. Jobs and facilities are not as abundant as today. Do you agree? Yeah, very difficult. And if you want to travel to go to see a master or to practice a retreat or something like that, and you have a family, is even more difficult than today. Today, you can do extra job, and then you can leave the family at home for a day or two or 1 week, and you fly home very quickly, or you go by train. In the old time, if you want to see a master and you happen to live very far away, you have to go on donkey, go on foot, and it takes months. Could be years. So how are you going to leave your family behind and discharge your duty as a spiritual practitioner at the same time? It's more difficult. That is if your family even let you go at all. And if your conscience allow you to do that. And to raise a family and to earn a living in the old time is very, very strenuous. We always talk about the good old time, like as if in before our time, everything is more abundant, everything is more glorious and more clean and pure. It's not true. If you see the picture of the old time, the photo or the painting, you see the chimney are smoking in the whole cities, right? And the horse manure is all over on the street, and the cows and the pigs are running everywhere, chickens and ducks are running in your apartment in New York, for example. Huh? Everywhere is not as clean as today. And not to talk about the bathroom, the toilet facility and all that. You know what it is like, huh? In the place of the dustbin today, there's a place of the the night pot and all kind of things. Yeah, that was the old time. If you are single, it's more easy for you at that time as a practitioner. Now you can picture the whole thing or not? Yeah? Okay. Because if you're a bachelor, you can just share a room with anybody or just live anywhere, huh? But if you have a family, a kid, and before our time, you want to control birth, it's very difficult too. Today you have more facilities. If you want to have two children, you can have two children. Well, accidentally, sometimes three or four, but but at least the majority has the opportunity to change the circumstance, yeah, or to choose. In the old time, no, you don't. So if you have a family, you're bound hand and foot. And that's why the master of the old time tell you, better be single. Huh? Understand now? So many things, it's not just that. And then suppose, if you became a master even after being practicing for a long time, and then you have a big family, how you travel to teach people and all that? Ah, yes, possible too. But you couldn't travel far. You couldn't stay long for months or something like that. There was a master in Muslim Sufis long time ago. He's very famous. His name is Mullah Nasruddin, if I'm right about the spelling. Yeah, he's a very funny guy. He has a wife and kids. But he also can discharge his duty as a master. But he was dirt poor. And he couldn't travel very far anywhere because he has only a donkey. And even sometimes people come and want to lend him, to borrow his donkey. So there was a joke about him. One time somebody came and wanted to borrow the donkey. And he said, no, the donkey is not here. Oh, he can tell lie too. White light. And suddenly the donkey, bah! You know, in the old time, people keep donkey beside the house, you know, or behind the house in the small room or small stable, huh? And the donkey, bah! And the neighbor said, huh? Master, you tell lie? Mullah, you tell, Mullah mean the teacher, huh? You tell lie? The donkey just, I say, the donkey just bay, huh? And the master was so indignant, standing up and saying, now you believe me or the donkey? Uh-huh. Okay, so much with the master. And one day he went to a neighbor, you know, talking about being dirt poor. He went to the neighbor's house in the garden and plucked some of the carrot and put it in his bag. You know, plug it in and put it in his bag and ready to bring home. And the neighbor saw and said, "Ah, Mula, just what you're doing, plucking my carrot and putting it in your bag like that?" And the master stood up and said, "Hey, yeah, I was just wondering the same question." And then you came. He also doesn't know what he's doing. Very cute guy. And then he also has family problem, even as a master. I mean, he doesn't talk that much, but just one or two joke, you know, give us a picture. Like one day he went to a shop, and then a shopkeeper sell a pair of sword, yeah? Very expensive, 50 gold pieces for a pair. And Mula just look at it and say, "Oh, what is this? Why so expensive? It's only made of a piece of iron, you know, at the most. Why is this 50 piece of gold in the old time? It's very expensive." So the owner of the shop said, "Oh, Mula, you don't know. This sword is magical sword. When you go out and fight, they extend longer invisibly and reach the enemy and kill them." So the master don't say anything. He went home. And he brought out a pair of fire tongs, you know, that you use to pick up the hot coal from the fireplace. Okay, they call it fire tongs, right? Okay, he brought to the shop owner, you know, a pair of fire tongs and said, "Here, sell this for 100 gold piece." You know? And the shop owner of the sword, you know, sword shop owner said, "Why, Mula? This is just an ordinary fire tong. Why 100 gold piece?" And the Mula said, "You don't know. This might look ordinary to you, but when my wife throw it at me, it can extend across the room of 50 yards." And reach me without fail any time. He's very cute. So if you have any problem with being single, you remember all this. If you're single, you have problem. If you're married, you have problem too. But being a single, there's a little less problem, I must say. Huh? More freedom. And maybe more lonesome. But when you're married, you have more fun. But more trouble also. You know, you pay for everything that you want to get in this life. And you have to be willing, either way, huh? So, make your own choice. It's not that if you're married, you cannot become a Buddha. Hmm? Yeah. And about the person who talk about his own problem, the money problem, that he saw money-oriented, remember? Yeah. Well, that's a normal reaction of the mind if we are into something and intensively concentrated on it. Yeah? The same if, suppose you quarrel with your spouse before you sleep or during that day, and then before you sleep, you didn't meditate enough. Then when you wake up, you still remember the quarrel yesterday. Yeah, it still disturbs you very much. Sometimes even you meditate a lot, and the disturbing is still there. So you just have to take time to let it go. But if you quarrel again the next day, and the next day again and again, then it will be very much disturbance. And then it's very difficult to forget it. So it is better that we try to construct a very harmonious atmosphere at home. And that's why I advise you to discharge your duty at home as best as you can, so that everyone is happy including yourself. And then you can meditate better. You don't feel disturbed in the mind while you meditate, or even after meditation or during meditation. Now concerning daily work, like making money and discharging your duty as your employment required, it's very difficult to put it down. That's why you have to meditate every day to erase some of it. But there is a solution to it. You know, even I sometimes, when I meditate, I think of the problem too, because it was at hand. And it's sometimes pressing, sometimes very difficult to get rid of. Yeah? So what I do is I write out the problem before I meditate. Okay, this I will have to solve. That's just one thing. I write it on a piece of paper and have a note book beside you or in your pocket, small one, so it's not heavy. And then a pen, I told you that many times, but I tell you again, this is more practical concerning your job. Because once you write it down, the mind feels better, okay, he's going to take care of it. It's already lessened the intensity and the pressure. When you finish your meditation, you can take care of it. You tell your mind this, and then it eases off. And then if you know the solution, okay, now I'm going to meditate. You know you're going to meditate, but you know the solution to your problem. Like, okay, I'm going to do this, do that tomorrow to make more money or to solve that problem. Then write that down too. And that's even better for the mind to calm down. But during meditation, sometimes you have better idea about how to solve that problem, how to make profit. But not to take money from other people unjustly. That I don't advise. And during meditation, maybe the problem is still there, and then you have some clear idea what to do. And then you write out immediately on a piece of paper the idea that come up in your head during meditation. Because that is maybe the master who answer you, who give you the solution. So write it down before you forget. And also, once you write it down, you're peaceful, and then you can continue to meditate. So don't hesitate. The meditation is not only to become a Buddha, I told you. It benefits you in many ways. Give you peace of mind, give you a clearer mind for your problem daily, and give you physical purification so that you become fit and healthy. There are many ways you can benefit from meditation. It's not only to become a Buddha or to be one with God. It's just the byproducts are plenty. Miracles happen and health are restored, and sickness is removed and problems is resolved. So do more meditation. And during meditation, if any ideas come up very clear to you, then write it down. And like this, you can continue meditate later, and the problem is gone. Okay? Understand? That's it. And suppose, after all this, the problem is still not gone, and it bugs you every day, and bugs you too often that you couldn't meditate, then you have to quit the job, or quit me. Yeah. There are some of our initiates before, after they became successful in some business, become rich and famous, they quit us too. Too busy, too engaged in socializing, in lobbying, in dinner party, lunch party, and meeting this and that high personage and famous personalities, etc., etc., and then more and more demand all the time of their time and their energies, and then they come home, they don't meditate anymore enough, and the less they meditate, the more they are involved in worldly activities, and the more they are involved in worldly activities, the less they can feel inclined to meditate. And so, you know, the vicious circle going, and then they live all together. And now completely successful in the world. Use up all the energy and the merit earned from the last period of meditation in the world again. I have told you to be successful in the world, but not as the cause of the spiritual progress. Understand? Because after we leave this world, we have nothing. We cannot bring anything with us. So if we cannot balance our life between spiritual and material gain, we have to quit one or another. So the choice is yours. Anytime we should choose the spiritual progress before the material gain, of course. But I could not force you to make one choice or another. I just tell you the consequence. Money and fame is this very, very strong, powerful tool that the Maya use to nip us from our spiritual aspiration. So be careful.